What is the title to this? We got somebody saying hot-blooded. Nope. Jen Alger, sharp-dressed man. Well done, Jen. Let's give Jen a hand. Well done. Okay. No more answers. All right, question number two. I'm only gonna get it after I've shown you. Question number two. Who wrote it? Dana B. Dana, you just keep sending me your name. Luke, that's just your name. ZZ Top! Who did that? Well, I know many of you did that, but who is... Jen Alger, again, she's flying on this, guys. She is flying. Jen, hold up your hand. If you don't know, she has lightning-fast fingers, okay? You're gonna have to be on your game if you're getting question three. Question number three, what year was it released? Start Googling. 83, oh my goodness. Tim Landefeld, way to go, Tim, well done. That was a good one, Tim Landefeld. All right, question number four. What is question number four? Name of the album. Oh wait. Well done, we got it. Hold on. No! Tim Landefeld again got in there. Mr. Lightning Fingers, well done. All right, guys. Okay, this is the bonus question. If you get this, you're impressive, okay? Bonus question, band's gonna pump it up for the bonus question, okay? Bonus question is, can you name the three members of ZZ Top? Oh. Yeah. Can you get the third one? Chip Hall named all three. Well done, Chip. He's back here. Woo! Very good. Thank you all so much for participating in our game. I've got to give honorable mention to Tim Landefeld for naming the three members Sleepy, Grumpy, and Dopey. Totally incorrect, but it was a good effort. Listen, we wanted to play that song, yes, because we thought it was a very manly song, but really we wanted to set up the real thing, which is we want to give a gift to one of our, don't let me feedback, I'm gonna feedback in front of that speaker. Thank you. All right. We wanted to give a gift to one of our sharp-dressed dads this morning. You are sharp-dressed, maybe because you wore khakis and a dress shirt today, but more because in the scriptures, we're talking about being clothed in righteousness. We talk about our actions being what people know us for, not necessarily our clothes. And this is someone who is a sharp-dressed man in all of his life. Mr. Mike Casey, you are our sharp-dressed dad today. Happy Father's Day, Mike. We appreciate you. Now it's time for us to sing some songs together. So what I would ask is that you stand and say hello to someone who's sitting near you.
One, two, three, four. Sing with us, When darkness
tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken. Sing my fear, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Shame no longer.
Shame no longer has a place to hide. To lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken. chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, there's power. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power. Resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance.
Good morning. As John said, we're so glad that you're here this morning. My name is Stephanie. We're so excited to be worshiping together. If you would continue in worship with this beautiful hymn, The Old Rugged Cross.
Clean.
prayer for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the truth that we sing, that the love that you showed us when you sent your Son to die for us, it's never ending and it's never changing. Jesus, we thank you so much that you gave yourself for us so that we could know you, so that we could be close to you and be with you for eternity. I pray right now, Father, that you would open our hearts to hear from you. May we hear from your word and grow. That you would call us and draw us each closer to you. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again, and you have
nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen. This is awesome. You may be seated. Each week we celebrate the story of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus through our songs, and in a way that some of you may not be used to. We take communion, or the Lord's Supper, each week. It will happen at the end of the service, and we would like to invite you to join us in that if you're a believer, even if it's your first time here. You're welcome to join us as the plates are passed. The servers will be passing the plates at the end of the service, and you just take a piece of bread and a cup of juice, take a few moments, spend some time in reflection, eat and drink when you're ready. Again, we're so grateful that you're here this morning. We are going to hear from Luke again as we continue our summer series in the book of Acts.
Good morning, good morning. Yeah, I did that with my back to you. Good morning. All right, sorry. Sorry about that. So as you will notice, John came up and he did the introduction, and he mentioned the fact that he was going to camp. And then he mentioned the fact that Diana was going to camp. And then he mentioned the fact that my wife was going to camp. You know who's not going to camp? This guy. And I'm telling you, my wife and I have been talking about this. This is a surreal moment for our marriage, because for the last 17 years we've been married, 15 of those years, I have been the one to go to camp or the missions trips or to go to somewhere. It's usually on Father's Day. I'm after Father's Day going, see you in a week and everything. She's been home and everything like this. So it's a very surreal moment for us where she is now leaving and I'm going to be home alone. Now, and this is something, and I feel like I've cheated my wife because she was never home alone. She always had the kids. So I apologize for this. It's just a season of life. I'm sure I'm going to go back to camp and mission trips one day, just not this year, okay? So if anybody wants to go to the movies this week, no, I'm just kidding. I'm going to be working. We have been doing this book of Acts, and we've been going through the book of Acts. John had started out the first couple of weeks, and I've been doing the last couple of weeks. Today we're going to be going, if you have your Bible apps, Acts chapter 6 through 8 is what we're going to be going through today. Last week I said that over the next couple of weeks, last week and this week, I'm going to be going over some things that are happening inside the church, both outside and inside the church. And what I said to you is the things that I'm talking about are things that are timeless. These are things that are going to be going on. They went on in the book of Acts, and we read this in the book of Acts, but they were things that went on then, and these are timeless things that I'm bringing out these last couple of weeks. They happened then, they will continue to happen, and I'm thinking that in the future, long after we're gone, if the church is still going, the church will, because that's what Jesus said. He said, nothing can stop this. These things that I'm talking about will continue to go on in the church. And last week I said, these are the things that were going on outside the church. The message was preached. People were witnessing. That's what John talked about the first week. People were witnessing. He had equipped them to witness. And like I said last week, from the time it started to before us to now to in the future, people will either accept or reject the message of Jesus Christ. That's just what's going to happen. It will always happen. And I talked about kind of some of the reasons why they accepted it, and just some of the powerful reasons why we accepted it, admitting our weakness, that Jesus, we need him, and coming to that understanding that it is only through Jesus Christ that we're saved. That's something that's we have to admit that, and we need Jesus. And then we talked about the fact that the Pharisees rejected Jesus, but they rejected Jesus based off this resurrection that they did not believe in. But they couldn't deny it because the evidence was so evident in the disciples, in the man that was healed last week that we talked about, in the fact that people were being converted. And what it boiled down to was just simple jealousy. They were jealous of what was happening, and we talked about that, the fact that sometimes we have to get over ourselves and let Jesus reign in our lives. So we talked about that last week. This week, I'm going to talk about something else, not something that's happening outside the church, but actually something that's happening inside the church. And so here's what's happening inside. Here's what we find out in the book of Acts. This church has problems. Now, I know that you might be shocked to hear this, because you would think that this thing just started, and you would think, golly, they're growing out the wazoo, and everything, everybody's accepting the message, people are giving, and people are doing this, but what you find as you continue to read is simply the church has problems, and this is something that we need to kind of recognize up front, especially as we, if you're ever interested in church, or maybe you're getting into this church thing, or maybe you've been in it a while, and then like, that's not a shocker to the people that have been in it a while. It's like, yeah, I know we got problems. You know what I'm saying? But I want to talk about why we have problems. And I want to just bring out the point that, you know what, creation doesn't always work the way God intended it to work. I mean, a lot of times when you think about God's church and you put the label God on there, you think, well, if God creates it, everything's great, you know? God can't make a mistake. But then we realize that God created church in the way that it was supposed to operate, yet it still had its problems, and it still continues to have its problems. So it's kind of a weird thing to say, but yes, even the things that God created, intended for one thing, doesn't always work out the way that God intended it to work. But there's a reason for that. It's because God uses human beings to accomplish his work. He uses us. And a lot of times what we don't realize is that when God entrusts his people, his creation, to do some of the things that he's intended it to do, you get problems. Because a lot of times we don't do what he intended us to do, and therefore it messes up what God intended it to do. Let me just give you an example of that. God intended parents to be the caretakers of their children, right? Yet we still have a pretty popular adoption place, people who are putting their kids up for adoption. We have a foster care system. I've been to youth ministry for a long, long time. I've seen some very tough situations where parents have either neglected their kids, dropped off their kids, not been paying attention to their kids. So even though that we were entrusted with this responsibility to be the caretakers of our kids, it doesn't work out that way. Because again, I think God, he didn't want that to happen, but it happens. And we have to realize that. We have to adjust. And that's why we have the foster care system. That's why we have the adoptions, the system that we've set up. Because what God intended to work did not work the way he intended it to go. Because we messed it up in some way, form, or fashion. Now, we are the caretakers of his church. We are the caretakers of his church. That's the way he set it up. And believe it or not, if God entrusts us to be the caretakers of his church, his mission, his message, we're going to have problems. We're going to have issues. We're going to mess it up at times, maybe at times a lot. And we have this saying here at church, and I've said it from the stage many times. I've said this, our church exists a lot of times. What we want our church to be is for people to give church a chance. Because we understand that people have been a part of a church, possibly when you were younger or when you were at another church, possibly, and possibly you got a raw deal at some point. Maybe you got upset. Maybe you got forgotten. Maybe you got overlooked. Maybe someone actually did something to you that you are angry about, and you left church at that time, and you were upset at what all went along in church. Or maybe you're not a part of a church, you haven't been, because you see what's happening in the world, and you see how messed up the church is, and you're like, oh, man, the church is problems. I don't even want to be a part of that. But maybe you're here saying, you know what? I'm just going to give church a chance. I'm just going to give it one more chance. That's the kind of church we want to be. We want to be a type of a church that people can say, you know what? I want to invite my friends, because this church is a place that I feel like they can give church a chance and it would work out good. But let me just be honest. At some point, you're going to give church a chance. Even this church, they're going to let you down. At some point, you're going to give church a chance. Even this church. And I have to admit that, okay? And I like to think we're a great church. In fact, I like to brag on us a lot. I like to brag. Anytime I go around with my minister's friends, they talk about their problems, and I look at them and say, not us. You know? You got that problem? Nuh-uh. You know? And so a lot of times, I like to even brag about what we got going on at Jeff City. I love our church. But at some point, we may let you down. And a lot of times, I think we get this, what I call social media version of the church. You know, when you're on social media, what do you post? You only post the good stuff. You ever seen some people who post food?
they don't post like bacon and eggs in the morning. You know what I'm saying? They don't post like Cheerios. You know what I'm saying? They don't post that. You know what I'm saying? They're at like a restaurant and they have like put it out there and it's like this chef has beautifully laid it out on a piece of a plate and they're like, ah, I'm a, you know, Calhoun's click, you know? And they post it. You know what I'm saying? Why? Because it's beautiful. You're out there at a beautiful place and you're posting it. You don't post like the bed in the morning, like dirt, like messy. You know what I'm saying? You don't post that. Why? Because it's uninteresting. We only post the good stuff, the things that we want out there. And a lot of times we get this vision of church, this social media that the church is all, like we read the book of Acts and like they were generous and they gave away their stuff and they were growing out, they were growing. You're like, oh, they just did it right. They were just right all the time. That was just, but look, it only took about a couple months before they messed things up. And that's what I want to talk about today, a little bit. I'm going to talk about a couple things today, but that's what I want to start with. Because I think we need to understand that. And it starts in Acts chapter 6, in Acts chapter 6, verse 1 through 7. Let me read this. In those days when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. Hellenistic Jews, Greek-speaking Jews were the Hellenistic Jews. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together. It would not be right for us, they said, to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men among you who are known to be full of the spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith in the Holy Spirit, Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, Nicholas of Antioch, a convert to Judaism. And they presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid their hands on them, so the word of God spread. Now, let me give you some background of what's happening here. There were older people who had been taken out of Jerusalem in the exile. Before all this was happening in the New Testament, there was an exile of the Israelite people, the Jewish people. So they were exiled. They were captives in Babylonia and in Persia and all these different areas. They were scattered in all of the known world, okay? But many elderly people, as they got along in age, and as as everything was coming back together in Jerusalem and it was being rebuilt and people could come back to Jerusalem, they were going back to Jerusalem in their old age so they could die in Jerusalem. Now, what was happening was a lot of the elderly women had lost their husbands in exile, or they had gotten back to die in Jerusalem and their husbands passed away. And it presented a problem for women back then when they lost their husbands and their families. They had no money. They had no way of making ends meet. So they would rely on the church to feed them. And they would join this movement called the Way. And what was happening was, is the Greek-speaking Jews, these people who were not a part, they were different language, they came in and they were being overlooked. Now, this is not so much about being discriminated against. This is the thing that we need to talk about. There was no, like, for example, you don't read in the book of Acts where these people who were discriminated had to, like, repent of their sin of discrimination. So they didn't include this in here to talk about discrimination and cliques. So I want to tell you why I think this is in here, to teach us about something. And this is what it's about. The church, it has to change organizationally if it wants to effectively meet the needs of its people and accomplish its mission. This is about a church. If you read in the beginning of Acts, was in the hundreds. But now there's a church in the thousands, 5,000, 8,000, 12,000. This was a massively growing movement. And what was happening is there were problems that were created inside this church movement, and it was having to be dealt with. And the person, I appreciate this. This is why I appreciate Luke, not just because we share names, but because he shared this version of the church, not the Facebook version, but this is what was really happening. He was like, listen, there were problems we had to deal with, and one of them was there were people being overlooked in the distribution of food. We were very generous, but they were being overlooked. And he was very honest about that and what they did about that. And we have to understand that as a church, especially a growing church, We have to have the ability to change as we grow, because if we don't, the people that come into our church, the people who give church a chance, the people who join our movement in Jeff City especially, they'll be overlooked. There'll be problems. And we have to change the way we disciple. Because again, we have a mission here at our church. We want to lead all kinds of people into a committed relationship with Jesus Christ and his church. We've said this over and over. We're going to continue to say this, by the way. And we have simply put a phrase around something that we believe they did in Acts. Something that, if you'll notice, the disciples were very, very pointed to make out in this scripture. And so we have to understand that there was a mission. And this church, for example, has been growing. Our first service, I think, was what, 10? I think we had 10? 11. Oh, yeah, sorry, 11. 11. It was 11. And we met like in a recreational laundromat. It was our first service. And my dad did an invitation, and I had to go forward to join the church. It's weird, but I always tell dad, you had 60% of the congregation come forward on your first message. You're never going to duplicate that. You know what I'm saying? That's pretty good, 60%, you know? But here's the thing. We were a growing church. We're still a growing church. We're going to be, God willing, a growing church. And so we have to understand that as a church, we have to change. And we have to move. Because we're gathering people, new disciples, we're accomplishing our mission. But here's the thing we have to recognize. Every church that grows and changes has to change the right way. Because if we don't change the right way, we're going to hurt each other. And most importantly, we'll hurt the mission that we're sent to preach and teach. And so I want to give you three things that I think we can do. This first point that I think we can do to change the right way. And here's the first thing we need to do. We need to marry the mission, and we need to date our model. That's a saying that if you go into a lot of church leadership things, you need to marry your mission, and you need to date your model. The disciples were very clear that their job was to preach the word of God. We have to do that. It is our responsibility to preach and teach the word of God. That's our mission, because we're preaching Jesus risen from the cross who saves everyone, and we need to preach that so people can repent and be baptized and become a part of this movement. That's our role. And so when this came up, they were like, this is something that we can't go about doing, because they were so committed to preaching Jesus Christ, preaching the word, bringing people in, making disciples. Again, we've put a fancy tagline into making people committed to it. That's a way that we talk about it. But this was happening when they were happening. And that's the mission. We can't lose that ever in the church. But the way that we disciple people has to change. The way that we disciple people has to change. For example, my father retired a couple of years ago. And when we replaced my father, we replaced not with just one minister who preached every Sunday, but two pastors. Well, that's what our church decided to do. We changed our model because we were a growing church, and we recognized a couple of things about pastors that says, listen, a pastor can't, in a growing church, has more needs in the church, and they have more administrative roles. And as the administrative roles grow, we need to trade that out and share our administrative roles. And while we do that, we need to share the stage. I think it's gone pretty well so far. But we changed our model a couple of years ago, and we were willing to change with a growing church. That's something that our elders decided was a good idea. So we're in the midst of changing the model even. But here's the second thing that we have to do. We have to watch out for sacred cows as we change. And a sacred cow, and I call it a sacred cow, we have to be careful that our traditions, especially our religious traditions, do not interfere with the change that we have. And we have to make sure that if we change something, we have to change the things, but don't hold on too tightly to some things that are, and let me just, if you've ever said the phrase, well, we've just always done it that way, get ready for a sacred cow. That's just what I'm used to. It's just the way we've always done it. Maybe you've heard this before. And believe me, you think that I'm talking about maybe older generational people. When I was a youth pastor, my first year in youth ministry, I had a sacred cow. And it was my Sunday night gathering with my students. I was meeting with, it was called Lighthouse, and it was our outreach program. And my goal with Lighthouse was to bring in new people, visitors. I wanted it to be a very place where new people could come in and feel comfortable. Well, I noticed, and I had this problem, that every time I had Sunday night church, only my kids that were already part of the church was coming to Lighthouse. And I was like really struggling with it, but I would not move Lighthouse from Sunday nights because I was committed to Sunday nights. one of my parents gave me an idea. Said, hey, Luke, why don't you move to Wednesday nights? I was like, what? That's not what I do. You don't understand. I have this on Wednesday nights. I can do that. And he goes, well, you'd have to get rid of that. I'm like, whoa. And so I had to think in my mind, can I do this? Can I disciple? Well, guess what? I changed it. And I was willing to go through that. Now, did it mess me up? Because my whole week was kind of structured around a Sunday night program. And I thought, this could hurt me. But it ended up being a good thing because I noticed more kids would give church a chance on Wednesday night than Sunday night. I just, for some reason, that's just how it worked that back then. And it worked. And I was able to bring in new people. But if I would have held tightly to Sunday night, this is the only time I can have my thing, I would have really hurt my ministry, hurt people coming to Jesus. John is always doing this as it relates to adult discipleship. The way that we disciple people has to change as we grow in church. But because quite frankly, our needs are different at different stages of life. I guarantee you, a young family with young kids who have childcare issues isn't going to be able to do discipleship the way someone without kids or somebody who's an empty nester. It's just different. And so when you talk about, well, do we do Sunday school or do we do small groups or do this? Well, that's all a question that we have to ask ourselves. We always have to ask ourselves those questions because, again, our goal is to make disciples and effectively teach those disciples. But we have to always understand how we do that has to be different. How we do that. And we have to be careful we don't get married to these things that we're always used to doing. We have to be flexible in these things, making sure that we never get rid of the mission. And the third thing we have to do is this. We have to be willing to speak up and step up. Thank the Lord that somebody was speaking up and saying the Hellenistic Jewish women were being overlooked. I don't know who that was. It didn't mention them. Maybe didn't want to mention them. I don't know. But thank the Lord that they brought this up to the attention of the disciples. They needed to do that. It was important to them. And they brought it up in such a way that didn't ruin the leadership. And thank goodness there were men who stood up back then that said, you know what, I'll take that. I'm going to allow you to do your job, and I'll take that. That's my thing. And I think in a church, especially a growing church, we have to have people that are willing to step up and say, I see this issue going on. Do it the right way. Do it respectfully. But always, always come up and speak up in the right way. Notice that we're not perfect, and we understand that. So we have to be willing to voice that stuff. But we also have to have people that once they say that, what? We have to have people that step up and change. So if we have everybody that steps up and speaks, because I think the speak up's the easy thing. You know, it's like, we got problems. Let me just tell you about them. And we can do that really well. But stepping up and getting involved and taking care of the problem as a collective group, that takes everybody. Everybody. So that we can work together and function the best. And so those are the things that if you want to change the right way, these three things are going to be real important, especially for us as we move forward. But it was definitely important for the first church as they move forward. Now, not only did you realize that the church had problems, here's the second thing you read in the book of Acts as you move on to chapter 7. There were always going to be obstacles that try to prevent the church from witnessing. There will always be obstacles that will try to prevent the church from doing its job and witness and bringing people to Jesus Christ. That's always going to happen. That's just the way it's going to be. And I used very intentionally the word obstacles. Because we meet in the seventh chapter of Acts a man named Stephen, who was famously the first one of the first famous martyrs of the church. Okay? And anytime you see Stephen's name, you see that he was a very influential guy in the church. In fact, right before I read that, Acts chapter 7, it said, now Stephen was a man full of God's grace and power, performed great wonders and signs among the people. And then opposition arose, however, from the members of the synagogue. And what we read about Stephen is that because of the way he was living his life, there were people who wanted to get rid of him. And they set him up very much similarly, if you read through that book of Acts in chapter 7, or actually the latter part of 6, going into 7, you'll read that they set him up in the legal system that they had set up in that day religiously, very similarly to the way that they set Jesus up. They sent in liars, and they sent in people to lie about him, and they brought him on a trial. Very, very similarly to the way they treated Jesus. And they put him on trial. And eventually, he was killed for his faith. He was martyred for his faith. Now, again, I put the word obstacles because if I'm talking to you and me today, how many of us woke up this morning very scared to come to church because of what would happen to them, the fact that they would be arrested and die? Very few of us ever kind of fear that, do we? Persecution is not really on the front of our minds. And I understand that. Now, I'm not saying it doesn't happen in the world we live in today. I'm not saying that. But I'm trying to put it in the context of the people I'm talking to this morning. And in America, the where we live, I don't wake up in fear of that losing my life. But I promise you this, you're going to have an obstacle in your life. You're going to have people in your life. Maybe it's a workplace situation, or maybe it's school, or maybe you're having a situation at home, or you're going to have an obstacle that's going to try to prevent you from sharing the message of Jesus Christ. And that's what I want to talk about. And here's what I want to share with you, is that in Stephen's life, but based on this verse, what you realize is he was being persecuted for a very specific reason. And this is it. He was living for something greater than himself. And so a lot of times, if you want to talk about obstacles and persecution, we don't need to talk about what we're willing to die for. This is the question we need to ask ourselves. What are we living for? What are you living for? Specifically, what story are you living for? Because I promise you this, whatever you live for is what you're willing to die for. Whatever you live for is what you are willing eventually to die for. I like to watch this show called Off Camera with Sam Jones. He's a photographer, but he decides to interview celebrities, and it's a very candid conversation. It's a very straightforward conversation with different celebrities, and I just love to watch the interaction because it's very laid back and it's very honest. But one thing I have noticed in every actor, like a famous actor who's become a famous actor, maybe an Oscar-nominated actor, is when they tell their story of why they're an actor or an actress, of why they do what they do, something very similar to all of this is like, you know what? When I was a kid, when I decided I wanted to be an actor, I moved to New York and I wasn't coming back until I was successful. What was your plan B? I had no plan B. That was it. In fact, if you want to make it in this industry, you can't have a plan B because that's plan A. And you figured really quickly that their plan was one thing. They lived for that acting position. They lived to be famous. They lived for that position. They lived for that job. And they said, you know what, I'm not going to go left. I'm not going to right. I'm going to go straight forward for that. And they were successful because of that mindset. That's what they were living for. And I think all of us have that in our lives. All of us have that thing in our lives that we live for, that we're not going right or left, and this is what I'm about. This is what I'm known for. This is what I do. This is what my money's spent. This is where my time is spent. This is what I'm living for. And a lot of times, when we get to that mindset, we'll figure it out. But the reason I wrote the word story is that Stephen lived his life for a story that he believed in very deeply, and it was God's story. And when Stephen was brought on trial, and he was asked to defend himself, the way that he defended himself was to tell them God's story. God's story that started in the Old Testament, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. He started going through stories in the Old Testament, and I do not have time to go through a 53 verse. I could just read it, but you'd be bored, quite honestly, with my reading. So I want to tell you, in your notes, if you have notes, I have cross-referenced every story that he told in detail. So if you want to go back and read, if you get your notes out there, you can see what Stephen was talking about in detail of the things that Stephen was talking about. But I want to hit like three or four things that he was talking about in subpoints. I want to kind of give you the cliff note version of what he was really talking about. And the first thing he explained to the leaders, and he explained in the Old Testament stories, is God made a covenant with his people to be their God. And he talked about that Acts chapter 7, 2 through 26. That's the story. He was telling them the story of Abraham, of Isaac, of Jacob, of Joseph. If you've been in church long enough, you'll call them the patriarchs of our faith. God made this covenant. He said, he told Abraham, I will be your God. You will be my people. That's my covenant to you. I'm going to lead you out of this land. I'm going to make you a great nation. And Stephen says, and he didn't have any kids at the time, but God promised him that they would be a great nation. And that promise continued to Abraham and Isaac and to Jacob and to Joseph. And even and he talks about even though Joseph was jealous, they were jealous, his brothers, the fact that he was chosen to be one of these people that God was going to bring this promise about with. God made this never-ending covenant with his people to be their God. And he follows that up with this after 26. Throughout history, he says, God has sent prophets and laws to remind us of his promise and prepare us for the Messiah. But throughout history, throughout the scriptures, his laws and his prophets were often rejected. And if you read Acts chapter 7, verse 27 through 43, you're going to see the story of one particular prophet who brought the laws, Moses. He was a prophet. They had been slaves of Egypt for 400 years. They cried out to God, and God sent them a prophet, a man named Moses. And he sent him through a burning bush, and he said, I want you to go free my people. And so through Moses, he went in to Pharaoh, and he said, let my people go. And Pharaoh said, no. And then he gave these plagues to convince Pharaoh and to also say, I am the only God, and all of your gods are not me. I'm the only God. There's a dual purpose in that. And eventually, God won. And Moses took the Israelite people out of Egypt into what they were promised, the promised land, the fulfillment of God's promise, into a land flowing with milk and honey. But it says, and he makes this point, that on their way, they stopped at Mount Sinai. And God says, I want you at the top of the mountain. I'm going to give you the laws in which we need to conduct ourselves so we can be the people of God. So he sent Moses to the top of the mountain so he could give him the laws. And the people accepted God's covenant. But Moses took way too long on the top of that mountain. And they got bored. They got hungry. And as Moses was receiving the law on the top of Mount Sinai, the people down below got tired. And they began to grumble. And the leaders, they fell under the grumbling. And they said, oh, it would be better for us to go back to Egypt and be slaves than to sit here and wait on Moses. So they built for themselves an idol, rejecting God and rejecting his laws. And they suffered for it. And so the purpose of that story was to simply say, listen, from the time of Moses, people have been bored with God. They've gotten bored with his prophets. Even though he sent prophets, even though he has sent laws to prepare us for Jesus, they've always been rejected. They've always been ignored. And he goes on to say, but God, he never left his people. He never left his people. Throughout the entire time through their punishment through the desert, he sent with them a tabernacle. He said, you build this tabernacle and you take this tabernacle wherever you go because I'm in the tabernacle. And then later on, he mentions David and Solomon in these verses in 44 through 53 in the fact that they went from a tabernacle to a temple. And he makes the point, same point that John made a couple months ago. This temple, it's not my idea. It's your idea. I was never meant to be in walls. I was never meant to be boxed up. But if you want to build this temple, go ahead. But if you mess up, this temple's gone. Because I'm not a part of this temple. This is not me. I was always meant to be with you wherever you go. And when Jesus came in the New Testament and he was about to be crucified on the cross, he looked at his disciples and he says, I'm going now. I'm leaving you now. But for those people who accept my message, and remember what Peter said to the people, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, and what? You will be forgiven of sins and receive what? The Holy Spirit. This Spirit will be inside of you, reside inside of you forever. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I was always meant to be with you. And so he told them the story of David and of Solomon. And here's the ironic thing as he's telling this story. They were the teachers of the law. They knew this story. They had heard this story 1,000 times. They taught this story to people 1,000 times. This was not news to them. This was not anything different to them. The ironic thing about him going through these whole thing is he's preaching to the choir. They know these stories. But here's the thing. There was a difference in Stephen's story and the way that he understood it and the way that they did it. This is where they went in different directions. Jesus was at the center of Stephen's story. It was all about Jesus. You see, they had something that they were trying to protect. And Stephen, he had given his life to Jesus. In the Old Testament, it all pointed to a day when Jesus would come and die for them. It all pointed to the Messiah. And when Stephen saw Jesus, that was his answer. It was at the center of his story. And that angered them because they didn't buy into Jesus. He wasn't their Messiah. And it says, he said, listen, you stiff, and this is him talking to the leaders. He said, you stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears, they're still uncircumcised. You're just like your ancestors. You always resist the Holy Spirit. Was there ever a prophet your ancestors didn't persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one, the Jesus. And now you've betrayed and murdered him. You've received the law that was given through angels, but you've not obeyed. You've not obeyed the story. You've not accepted Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. If you look at the title of our series, God's story is our story. So let me ask you a question. If Stephen's story that he told is for them, it's also for us. Let me ask you a question. Who's at the center of your story? Who's at the center of your story? Because we all have one. We all have one. And we have to ask ourselves as we're going about our life and if we're doing what we're living for, who's at the center of your story? Are you Stephen? Or are you these? Or do you better relate with these Pharisees who have something to protect, something to gain? It's not about Jesus. It's about what I can get, what I can receive. It's because, believe me, from the time of the Old Testament to what Jesus said to them in Luke chapter 9, verse 23 through 25, Jesus said this, whoever wants to be my disciple has to deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it if someone wants to gain the world, yet loses and forfeits their very self? What good is it? He's been saying this forever. And here's, we need to understand this. Jesus may not be asking you to sacrifice your family, your finances, your work, your dating relationship, all these things that we have in our lives, your marriages. He may not be asking you to sacrifice everything like he did Stephen, because he did ask Stephen to do that. He was asking Stephen to die. Now, we may never experience that. But when it comes to your family, when it comes to your work, when it comes to your finances, your marriage, your dating relationships, when it comes to everything that's your part of your story, when it comes to all that, what Jesus is saying in this verse is, I want to be in the center. I want to be in the center of your family. I want to be in the center of your work, your finances, your dating relationships, your marriage, everything about you. And you have to ask yourself and consult and give in and read and understand, is Jesus going to be pleased with what decisions I'm making in this area of my life? I want to be the center. That was offensive to the Pharisees, and it says, when the members of the Sanhedrin heard this, they found furious and they gnashed their teeth. But Stephen, again, he was full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, see heaven open up and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. And as they covered their ears, they yelled at the top of their voices. They all rushed at him, dragged him out into the city, and they began to stone. And they had thought, we win. We've gotten rid of this guy. Guys, this story, this Stephen martyr story, is the catalyst for the church. This is like a turning point in the book of Acts. This started a movement when they saw this happen that they couldn't. They thought they had ended this movement with the death of Stephen. They had just started something, because immediately after that, it says that the people heard this story and they began to be scattered. They began to be persecuted. But wherever they went, it says in Acts chapter 8, 4, those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. They were scattered. And it says in the book of Acts, something that was actually predicted in the first chapter of Acts, when he said this word needs to be preached in Judea, Jerusalem, Judea, in fact, all the world. Well, it says specifically in the book of Acts that the first place that they were scattered to was Judea, Jerusalem, Judea. And that's where the word went. This was the culmination of what they predicted. And John is going to come back next week and talk to you about how it went to the entire world. And he's going to introduce you to a man that was holding the coats, that was holding the coats of the Pharisees and the Sadducees stoning Stephen, a man named Saul. A man that God looked at and said, I think I could use him. How odd. But before we go on, we're going to experience something that's always been a part of our story here at this church, here in the church, and it's this table. We're on the night that Jesus was betrayed, and as the servers come forward, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke it, and he said, this is my body. It's broken for you. Whenever you eat this bread, I want you to remember. I want you to remember this night, but also what's about to happen. My body broken for you. He took the cup and he gave it to him. And he said, I made a covenant, right? But this is the blood of the new covenant. This is the blood of the new covenant. No longer are we going to be separated by sacrifices, by rituals. Nothing separates us. Now, the thing that connects us is my blood on the cross. My blood on the cross, the new covenant, is what we have now. The forgiveness of your sins. All are welcome at the table. So if you're a believer and you believe that Jesus died for you, if you believe in that sacrifice, we invite you to share in this story. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Father, for continuously keeping your promises to us. Father, for being there for us. And even though throughout history there have been people that reject you, that reject your laws, Father, thank you for never leaving us, never forsaking us. So as we come together, Father, let us share in this wonderful story. It's in your son's name.